So I would like to welcome Dr. R. Nagaswamy. Dr. R. Nagaswamy is a world-renowned expert in the field of art, including archaeology, museums, temple culture, history, epigraphy, numismatics, music, dance, public affairs, ancient law and society, literature and education, and has earned international distinction in art and culture. He has appeared as expert witness in many high-profile cases, most spectacularly in the following two cases. He was an expert witness in the London High Court on behalf of the Government of India, and it was his testimony which helped bring back the Nataraja back to Tamil Nadu, India. He was also expert witness in the Allahabad Court, Lucknow branch in the Rama Janmabhoomi or Babri Masjid demolition case, deposing for a full 26 days before the court to confirm the existence of a temple beneath the mosque based on the evacuation undertaken by the Archaeological Survey of India. An archaeologist by profession, he retired as a director of archaeology, Government of Tamil Nadu. He has also established an institute of epigraphy to train students in epigraphy and archaeology. He has been bestowed with many awards, fellowships, and titles, notably among them the title of Kalai Mamani, bestowed on him by the Government of Tamil Nadu under the chief mentorship of late Selvi J. Jayalalitha. Dr. Nagaswamy has completed his master's in Sanskrit from Madras University and has PhD from Deccan College, Pune. He has published 54 books and produced 13 dance Deccan dramas, apart from conducting excavations in 10 historic cities as part of his archaeological work. Dr. Nagaswamy has been appointed as honorary faculty member of Arsh Vidya Gurukulam by Pujya Shri Dayanand Saraswati Swamigal and awarded the title Vidya Seva Ratan by Shri Kanchi Kamakoti Peethadhipati Shri Jayendra Saraswati Swamigal. So without further delay, I would like to welcome Dr. R. Nagaswamy.
Mr. Chairman and friends, I will give a few important points about this conflict between Buddhism and Hinduism, and then show you some slides. Hopefully, it will be useful in understanding. I think this concept of conflict between Buddhism and Hinduism itself is wrong. In Indian context and Indian religious system, we have adoration of multiplicity of God. There is no need that I should have only one God. I adore and worship different gods at different period. Shivaratri, Shiva, and Ashtami, we worship Vishnu, Durga, all this. So it's possible for us to worship different gods with the same devotion without any conflict. But we glorify one God at one particular time contextually, and all other gods come as what you call secondary deities. In great temples, if you go, you have main God in the sanctum, and there are several circles of secondary gods going around it. They are called Avaranas, Avarana Devatas. So, I think in the Western mind, they can't understand that we can have, we can worship Shiva and also Vishnu and Buddha. So, I think Mr. Pollack has not understood the problem, and he's not the only person. There are others also who speak of Buddhism and Hinduism are mutually opposed. I'll give you another example. There is Shaivism and also there is a Vaishnavism. In Shaivism, they adore Shiva. And Vaishnavism, they adore Vishnu. That does not mean that these two are fighting each other and that they are different religion. We hold both of them as Hindu religion. Similarly, we worship Shiva and Durga. One is male and another is female deity, female goddess. Not, they are not separate. We still call them as Hindu gods. Similarly, if you know that Buddhism was part of Hinduism and Hinduism was part of Buddhism. So there is no difference in historical context, from epigraphical context, and also from philosophical context. So to talk of these differences is only exhibiting ignorance of fundamentals of Hindu system, Indian system. If you don't want to call it Hindu system, all right, you call it Indian system. We have no objection at all, no problem. But it is part. Then how do you justify that it is part when you have so many differences in philosophy? And so, yes, philosophies are different. Contextually, we speak about it. For example, we have our friend, respected scholar, Romila Thapar. She writes in her book on the history of India, ancient history of India, that she says, Ashoka preached Buddhism. And then she says, it was his, he introduced Dharma as a political theory. And then she says that he was anti-Brahmin and so on. But look at what he himself has written. Ashoka has written on rock, Ashoka has written on pillars, pillar edict, rock edict, stone edict. Look at it, what he says. There is no antagonism anywhere. Ashoka telling that I am anti-Brahmin or anti-Brahminism. On the other hand, you see that wherever he had been, even to Vaishali and other places, he says that I went, adored Brahmanas, gave them gifts, and then he went on to worship Buddha. So in many of his these things, worship of Brahmanas is specially mentioned. In one, Brahmana and Thera should be worshipped, adored, and gifts should be made. So there is no question of Ashoka anti-Brahmanism. Having said all that he is anti, I think they were a tank. Though he is friendly with Brahmana, I think they were different. That's what she writes in her book. I don't think that it is historically correct, factually correct, and it's not to be accepted. We cannot project. Unfortunately, we have been projecting it in the school. Millions of our children are indoctrinated, telling that these people are different and they are fighting and so on. Now, wherever you have doubt, Ashoka says, wherever you have doubt, go to the Brahmanas, holy Brahmanas. Yatate tatra varte ran. This is a Upanishadic statement which he actually repeats. Ashoka repeats it as it is. Yatate tatra varte ran. Tatate tatra varteta. You follow them. And that they are the holy Brahmanas. He says it's a holy Brahmanas. Whatever they do, they will do honestly, sincerely. And if you have doubt about Dharma, what I have to follow, you go and follow them. That's what he says. So it is there. You can go and verify Ashoka's inscriptions, and this is what he says. So there is no question in the time of, even in Dhammapada, you have references to Buddha, referring to Brahmanas. So Brahmanas were not anti anybody. They were adoration of what you call Samadarsana. Suni chaiva supakecha panditaha samadarsinaha. This is the statement of Krishna in what you call, is Bhagavad Gita. Then, friends, from historically point of historical point of view, I can tell you that in Tamil Nadu, there is a famous place called Mahabalipuram. And there you have got an excavated cave temple for Durga. And in that temple, there is an inscription on the lintel in Pallava Grantha characters of 8th century AD. And that is a temple dedicated to Vishnu as Varaha. There, that inscription reads, Matsya Kurma Varahascha. Matsya Kurma Varahascha Narasimhascha Vamanaha. Narasimhascha Vamanaha. Ramo Ramascha Ramascha. Please note, Ramo Ramascha Ramascha. One is Parasurama, another is Balarama, and another is Kodandarama. Ramo Ramascha Ramascha Buddha Kalki Dasasmrita. 10 avatars are listed in 8th century in an inscription where in the 10 avatars are mentioned. There after 3 Ramas, it mentions Buddha Kalki Dasasmrita. Buddha is part of the avatars of Vishnu, Dasa avatars of Vishnu. Similarly, then what happened to Krishna? You have 10 avatars. In this 10 avatars, Krishna is not mentioned. What happened to it? Is he not one of the avatars of Vishnu, important avatars of Vishnu? Vishnu, Krishna is always considered as Vasudeva. He is Parabrahma. He is the embodiment of all these 10 avatars. So, he is the acme of all these 10 avatars. Now, how do you know that? You go to the National Museum here. There are several images of Vishnu. And they are all very big. Obviously, they are in the Garbhagriha under worship, adored. And there are, on the Prabhavali, all the Dasa avatars are portrayed. Number of medieval sculptures, 10th century, 11th century, 12th century. Please go and see, have a look at it. Open your eyes and see. And in Dasa avatara, again, what you see is Matsya Kurma Varahascha Narasimhascha Vamanaha Ramo Ramascha Ramascha Buddha Kalki Dasasmrita. So it is not confined to only Tamil Nadu. It's confined to no one singular area. Similar, you have from Gujarat area to Middle India, Gangetic Valley. You go to what you call Palas and Sena sculptures. Wherever the central figure is Vasudeva, also called Paravasudeva, and then you have this 10 avatars portrayed, where you have always Buddha worship. That means the Hindus who were worshipping Vishnu in the temple, they were worshipping him as God, Supreme God. And so also in Buddha Charita, Atsagosha, when he speaks of Buddha's birth, he says he looks like the very Surya on earth. So in another place, we get references to him as Narayana. Buddha is called Narayana. So it is a syncretic religion, and even in some parts of northern parts of India, they do this sankalpa. When they do the sankalpa, they always say Baudhavatare. This is, you know, Manu, Vaivasvata Manvantare and so on. Then they say Baudhavatare. So the Hindus worship Buddha as part and parcel of avatar of Vishnu, and so it's part of Hinduism. Nowhere we see difference. Come to Buddhism. When you come to Buddhism, you have a great text. You know all the what you call Theravada and Mahayana. In all the Mahayana, you have so many deities are worshipped. You go to the most important Buddhist country is Sri Lanka. In Colombo, you have a big Buddha Chaitya. Big one. It's called Gangarama. You go there, as you enter, 8 feet big Narayana sculpture is there, Narayana painting is there, and then by the side is Sri Lakshmi. It is a Theravada country, and the temple we are going is a Buddha Chaitya, but what you see is Narayana. So Buddhists also, they worship Vishnu as part of their religion. There is no question of isolating him. Similarly, we have one important text called Nishpanna Yogavali. This is a 10th, 11th century text by one Abhayakara Pandita, great man. He has given 21 chakras of Buddha, Buddhist deities, to be worshipped. In all the 21 chakras, you see on the top, Buddha will be there. It is something like a Meru. And then you have number of circles of devatas portrayed where he mentions Ganesha, Kartikeya, Durga, and Saptamatas, and then Vishnu, Shiva, Brahma, and so on. Then, and the other last one, what you call Indra, Varuna, Yama, Nirriti, Vayu, Kubera, Isama. All these dig devatas are also given. All that you have to do is, you change the place of all these secondary deities. One is in the east and in another one is in the south or something like that. It becomes a different chakra. So 21 different chakras are related. It is a Buddhist text. Nishpanna Yogavali is a Buddhist text ascribed to 10th, 11th century, probably in Gujarat region or Rajasthan. Now, once you understand it, now there is a sculpture in the Indian Museum at Calcutta. There, Buddha is in Parinirvana pose, sleeping. And in the above, there is a stupa indicating symbolically that it is his Parinirvana. Now, in the pedestal, you have got one circle of Kartikeya and Ganesha. Then another circle, the Dig Devatas, Indra, Varuna, and so on. Yes. If you understand this, you can understand Southeast Asian countries. If you go to Thailand, Cambodia, and other places, they are all Buddhist countries. But you have lingas, Chaturmukha lingas, where you have Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, and Buddha. The fourth face is Buddha. So there are many images where the kings died. They were all Buddhist. For them, memorial object worship is Shivalinga. There's one Brahmana, and then I'll show you a few slides only. One Brahmana, 6th, 7th century, and there is an inscription which says, he is Veda Vedanga Tattvajnaha. Sanskrit inscription in Cambodia. Veda Vedanga Tattvajnaha. And what is he? He was also an expert in Saugata Tantras. He himself is a master of Buddhist Shastras. And he was appointed as the minister of and then Thailand, I need not tell you about. It's virtually Buddhist. He is an expert on Thailand, Thai art and Thai culture. And you see, he goes to the Buddha. First he goes to the Hindu temple, Brahman temple. And then he goes to the Buddhist temple, the king. And so that I'll show you a few of them with his permission, and then we go. Now this is the temple Brahman temple, Vishnu. It is in the center of Bangkok. So the king, in December, when he had the swing festival, he has organized a swing festival where Tamil hymns are sung, and this is the one he goes there and he worships. Yes. And this is the swing. This is a Hindu tradition. And now, of course, they have stopped it because some fellow fell down from 80 feet high, and so they have stopped it. Otherwise, they were doing it. Next one, please. Look at this. This is a golden swan in the Brahman temple. This is for the Brahma, worshipping God Brahma, the creator. It is still there under worship. Next. Look, you can see Brahma himself. Next. And then this is Shiva. Shiva, Vishnu, and then you have Brahma, and also there is a linga there. And then there is the image of Rama. They worship Rama because they consider themselves as embodiment of Rama. And they were in that Ayodhya. Now this also that Brahman temple. Next. See, this is the manuscript. They gave me special permission to photograph it. And this contains 30 bundles, not one. In this, you have the first Vastu Devata Puja, and then Hanumat Puja, and then there are a lot of stotras, Hindu gods and goddesses, and then the Tamil version. And they read it even now during December. It's all Hindu concepts. Who is worshipping it? The king of Thailand. Who is he? He is a Buddhist. And the Brahmana who consecrated him has got Vamadeva Muni, Tatpurusha Muni, and so on. Next one, please. Look at that. This is in nearly Thai script, they say. And some people say this is a 14th century Khmer script of the Cambodia, which from where they brought this one. Next one, please. Now this is a part of the palace. Next one. We are entering now. But next to this Brahman temple, you have this. Look at this. It's not going on. Don't worry. It's all right. Only one or two more. Look at this. Golden Buddha. This is where he goes. After worshipping the Hindu temple, he goes here. And see, all of them are golden Buddhas. So there is no difference between Buddhism and Hinduism or Indian system. Next. Next. Pada, Sri Pada. Worship of Sri Pada is common to both Hindus, both Indian and... Okay. So look at that. I shall stop it here because you will feel very uncomfortable. Anyway, this goes on. I just wanted to show you that also in Cambodia, also in other parts, you have Bhairava Murti worshipped. So, Hinduism and Buddhism were part and parcel of one philosophical thought and one religious thought. And this is very well illustrated when you go to Nepal, where you get all of them. So, friends, this Pollack, what is it? Sheldon Pollack, and our friend, she's a good writer, Ramila Thapar. But they all have projected wrongly the Indian system, and we have to take the story of truth, fact, to our children. School children, millions of children, don't indoctrinate them. That's what is being done.
To help me, you can do two things. You can go to the subscribe button on my YouTube and subscribe. We need more subscribers there. Secondly, I get lots of emails on people saying, how do we donate? How can we help you? You go to rajivmalhotra.com or you go to infinityfoundation.com and you can hit the donate button. You can donate in dollars. There are different ways mentioned. If you want to donate in rupees, there is a column called Infinity Foundation India, and you click that, and there are instructions on how you can donate in India.